Thank you for attending Shady Grove Fertility's webcast on age and infertility.
Welcome, everyone, and thank you for joining our program this evening. Dr. Stephen Greenhouse will discuss tonight the effect of age on fertility, when to seek medical help, and the treatment options available to overcome infertility. A brief background on Dr. Greenhouse. He is a board-certified in obstetrics and gynecology and reproductive endocrinology and infertility. After completing his fellowship program at George Washington University in 1998, he joined the Shady Grove Fertility Centers and established the Annandale and Fair Oaks offices. Dr. Greenhouse has received numerous awards and recognition, most recently being named a top doc in Washingtonian magazine. The presentation tonight will run approximately 30 minutes, and there will be plenty of opportunity for questions at the end. During the program, if you like, the interactive question feature located at the bottom of your screen will allow you to ask questions as we go along. Just note that everyone will be able to see the responses unless you ask us to mark your response private. Tonight is the first seminar we are doing using this web-based technology, so please be patient, and thank you again for joining us. Dr. Greenhouse?
Thank you very much for taking the time to join us in this web conference. Tonight I really want to kind of go through and basically discuss with you all a little bit about the impact of age on an infertility. I think it's very important that everyone have a good understanding of the impact, because I think knowledge certainly is power. And we certainly know that going through infertility treatment and testing is certainly a very stressful part of your life. And the unknown, I think, only makes that harder. The first couple of slides, I really just want to get some idea of the audience out there, and it would be helpful for us in regards to knowing who we're talking with so we can kind of tailor the seminar most appropriately. So if you can go ahead and maybe over the next 10 to 15 seconds, if you could answer these questions. I'd like to thank you for going and answering those questions. It gives us a good idea, again, of how we can best make the seminar appropriate for you. During this lecture, I want to go ahead and kind of hit upon a couple of topics. One, I want to kind of go through an introduction, talk a little bit about the physiology of the number of eggs in the body. I want to talk about some of the natural history surrounding pregnancy and age. How do we assess ovarian reserve? And I also want to touch a little bit upon some treatment options. So just a couple of infertility facts. The average chance of becoming pregnant each cycle is only about 20%. And this number is actually really, when it was studied, was actually looking at women who were probably in their 20s. A woman's chance of pregnancy is about 20%, as I said, for women in her mid-20s. By the time a woman is 40, her fertility potential is approximately half of that. Typically, the majority of people will become pregnant within 5 to 6 months of trying to conceive. And one out of every six couples will have difficulty in trying to conceive. There are estimated close to 2.5 million new infertility cases each year in the United States. And there approximately have been a little over a million deliveries worldwide of babies using assisted reproductive technologies. So certainly over the years, fertility treatments have certainly become used more frequently. So if you go ahead and answer this particular question, to get a sense of people's understanding. Most of you actually had polled that actually infertility has increased over the years. And actually, studies really have not borne this out, that the overall incidence of infertility has remained relatively unchanged over the last 30 years. However, really the evaluation and the treatment of infertility has changed markedly over this time period. And because of the better success that's available now, more people are seeking treatment for their infertility. It's also become much more acceptable. I think, you know, several 20, 30 years ago, it was less acceptable to kind of talk about it. And now certainly there are, as you all are more than aware, there are support groups out there. There are web support groups, and people are talking more about their infertility. I think people are seeking care because success rates are much higher. And kind of looking at the, you know, is infertility more common today? There have really been three major developments that have had the greatest impact on people needing fertility treatment. One is related to the advancements in technology, especially with in vitro fertilization over the years. And certainly the success rates has markedly improved in the last 10 years. Also, there's been a change in the population demographics. A lot of women are now entering into or careers or coming first, and they may be delaying when they want to have children in order to establish their careers. But unfortunately, nature has not been kind in regards to allowing women to both pursue careers as well as having children. So if they wanted to delay childbearing, that is important that they understand what potentially this impact may have. People are also getting married a little bit later, and also there have been improvements in contraception over the years. And again, there's been a rather big surge of media attention and public awareness to infertility. So we kind of look at what is the impact of age on the ability to conceive within a year. As you can see, approximately 85% of women between the ages of 20 and 24 will actually get pregnant within 1 year. And by the time a woman reaches her mid to late 30s, approximately 50% of those patients will be able to conceive. Similar to what I talked about before, that fertility potential does decrease. It's important to look at that these numbers are related to conceiving spontaneously, naturally, and not with the use of fertility treatment. But again, it's very important that when we look at that number of 52% of women getting pregnant spontaneously, it really allows us to encourage patients to pursue their evaluation earlier on in their course. So why does fertility treatment, why does infertility become more prevalent as women become older? Why do women have more difficulties conceiving? And this is really related to probably two major factors. One is related to egg number, and the other is related to the quality of those eggs. And I'm sure a lot of you are very familiar with this, especially through your own research and talking amongst each other in regards to various testing that we do when we want to look at the ability for women to conceive in order really the assessment and give us a better idea of prognosis of conception. I think this is an important question that I'd be very interested in seeing in regards to really who has discussed this with you or encouraged people to seek treatment sooner than they may have otherwise thought was necessary. So roughly speaking, it looks like about half of you have really seek the advice or have received a lot of information from your general OBGYN, as well as a good percentage of you all are also done your own research, which I certainly applaud you for, because I think it's very important that one is proactive with their medical care, whether that's related to infertility or any other area of medicine, especially with the web out there. There's a lot more information out there, and patients should take an active role, and I think that the general public is getting much more educated in regards to their care and their options. When we look at the ovarian physiology, as I mentioned before, in regards to the chances of conceiving, and one of the issues that comes about is related to the number of eggs within the body. That a woman is born with a certain number of eggs. She's born with approximately 2 million eggs when she's born. Actually, when you were inside your mother at around 20 weeks gestation, you had about 20 million eggs. By the time a woman has her first menstrual cycle at the age of approximately 12 to 13, she's really down to around 400,000 eggs. then a woman will typically only ovulate approximately 1% of her eggs in her lifetime. And the vast majority of those eggs actually go through a natural dying process that happens to be called apoptosis. And as you can see, that with as women get older, the number of eggs in the body certainly begins to decline. And that the declining certainly begins to increase, you know, certainly around the age of 30. And then certainly after the age of 40, there's a steady decline in the number of eggs within the body. And this is, again, one very important factor in why women have more difficulties conceiving as they get older. So you can take the opportunity to kind of give an idea of this particular question. I think it would be insightful. Well, I think many of you are going to be quite surprised by the next slide when we actually look at the number of eggs that are chromosomally abnormal as a woman gets older. And as you can see from this slide, that as a woman gets older, the number of eggs that are chromosomally abnormal dramatically increases from approximately 15% when a woman is less than 30 to approximately 82% when a woman is 42 years of age. And by the time a woman is 45, approximately 100% of her eggs are chromosomally abnormal. Now, this is looking at a population of women who are having difficulties conceiving. We certainly all know of women out there, hear stories of women getting pregnant spontaneously when they're 45. It just happens infrequently. Now, it's important that you realize that this is related to chromosome abnormalities within the egg. This does not mean that if a woman gets pregnant at the age of 42, whether spontaneously or through treatment, that she has an 80% chance of having a child with a chromosome abnormality. The vast majority of eggs that are chromosomally abnormal will never implant or never fertilize, and approximately 99% of chromosomally abnormal embryos will actually, if they do implant, will actually be lost by a miscarriage. So the question is, well, why do women, as they get older, why do they have an increasing number of eggs that are chromosomally abnormal? And we certainly feel that we have a good reason for this, and it has to do with the meiotic spindles. And kind of reaching back to your biology days in junior high and high school, the meiotic spindles are important for separating the chromosomes. And you may recall that there are 46 chromosomes within a normal human cell. And in order for a woman to conceive and have a healthy child, the chromosomes of the egg need to separate. So you get 23 chromosomes, and then the sperm contributes to the other 23. But as a woman gets older, the meiotic spindles become dysfunctional. So if you look here, you can see those little red dots on the WT stands for wild type, which means normal. And that's actually showing a nice alignment of the meiotic spindles. Whereas, as a woman gets older, you can see here that the meiotic spindles become quite disarray and disorganized. And this is very important because if you look down in section B, what you'll see is a nice clean separation of the chromosomes into two separate parts. But again, as a woman gets older, you can see that the chromosomes are not separating in a normal fashion, and therefore you end up getting an egg that's chromosomally abnormal. And that's probably the biggest reason why the eggs become more chromosomally abnormal as women gets older. If we look here now at this schematic in regards to kind of what's happening, a little easier possibly to see, you can see here in the egg that this particular egg happens to have three copies of chromosome 21. Normally, a human only has two copies of each chromosome. And as you can see down here, the sperm is only contributing two of the chromosomes. And this is if this egg fertilizes, you end up with an extra set of the 21st chromosome. And you can see here that we have three chromosomes 21 and two chromosomes 22. And this embryo, if it went on to delivery, the child would have Down syndrome. Recently, probably in the last couple of years, there's been a gaining of information in regards to the number of eggs that are chromosomally abnormal. This has primarily actually been through the development of something called pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. And this is accomplished by around the third day of the of embryo development, we're capable of actually removing a single cell from the embryo, and we can go ahead and analyze that chromosome, that cell, for its chromosomes. And this is actually showing you what the Dr. Kearns, who does the PGD for us, what it would actually see. And what you normally will see is you want to see only two chromosomes. So here, if you look in the yellow, this one has two normal ones, and it has two blue ones. But it has three sets of the red ones. Now, you may be seeing the other ones up in the corner, the red ones, but those are a different chromosome. So this is a cell that is showing an extra set of chromosomes, and again, this would be what we call a triploidy or a trisomy. And this embryo either would not implant, or if it did implant, there's a very high likelihood of miscarriage, or if a child was born, then there potentially could be difficulties with that child. When we look at the chances of conception in couples as they become older, certainly if we look at our data from Shady Grove Fertility Centers, that we're having, you know, close to, this is the delivery rates, we're having approximately a 50% delivery rate in women under the age of 35. But that number really decreases down to around, 20% in women over the age of 40. Or 41. And again, this is primarily secondary to a decreased chance of the embryos to be able to implant, as well as a higher miscarriage rate. And we look at, again, the impact of age on spontaneous miscarriages. Again, as you can see, that there really is an increase. As a woman is in her 20s, the chance of miscarriage is approximately 10 to 15%. But as she gets older, that number steadily increases. And certainly by the time a woman is approximately 45, she may have had high as a 50 to 60% chance of miscarriage if she was to become pregnant. Again, the likelihood of pregnancy at that age is much smaller, but if she was to become pregnant, then again, there'd be a very high chance of miscarriage. Well, how do we predict what the chances of success? When we're meeting with a couple in our office, how do we discuss with them and explain to them what their chances of conception will be? And sometimes the information we have to provide is difficult for us to tell patients, because clearly if someone is older, if they're 41, 42, a lot of them have never heard that their chances of conception or delivery may be low. And that's very difficult for us as fertility specialists, because we certainly want to provide for the patients to accomplish the goals that everyone wishes for. But I think the most important predictor of a woman's ability to be able to conceive is her age. And I'm going to go through the other predictive points out there, such as day 3 blood testing, including FSH and estrogen levels, which I think everyone has heard of, as well as a Clomid challenge test. But even if a woman has a normal FSH level or normal Clomid challenge test, and she's 40 or 41, age again is an overriding factor in regards to their chances of success. When we look at the day 3 blood testing, on the third day we don't like to see the FSH level elevated, and we believe the reason for that is that if the egg cells are healthy, they make a substance called inhibin that actually decreases the FSH levels and makes the FSH levels to be low. And if the egg cells aren't healthy, then the FSH levels will rise. We also are beginning to look at antral follicle counts, ovarian volume, as well as inhibin. And I'm primarily going to be looking at the first three. So this chart is actually from the Society of Reproductive Medicine, looking at the ART cycles that were done for the year of 2002. And the upper line here is related to women using donor egg, and the lower line is for women using their own eggs. And as you can see, as other slides have shown, that certainly by in the mid-30s, pregnancy rates are beginning to decline. Certainly after the age of 39, pregnancy rates markedly decline. But if you look back at the donor egg, the top line, they stay pretty much the same across the board. And what we believe this means is that the rate-limiting step in women becoming old, becoming pregnant is not related to their uterus. It's typically related to the quality of the egg. And this is just showing pregnancy rates based upon FSH levels in women under the age of 40. And again, if someone has a normal FSH level, they have a very good chance of conceiving. But if their FSH level is elevated, then unfortunately the chances of conceiving are very poor. This is the next question is a very common question that we get, is that a woman comes in and that she has a normal FSH level, but then a little while later we repeat it and abnormalities with it. And it's actually, it is quite common that FSH levels will rise with age and certainly over a time period. So this is looking at women under the age of 40 over here, and if they had a normal FSH level initially, within 1 year, approximately 15% of them would go on to have a abnormal FSH level. Over the age of 40, that number rises from 25% up to 63% within 1 year. So I think it's very important that this level is screened, and just because you have a normal FSH level going into your treatment, you still need to remember that, in fact, it may be elevated in the future. Real quickly, the Clomid Challenge test is a dynamic test, a kind of a stress test on the ovary. Again, we're measuring the baseline hormone levels on the third day. Then a woman takes Clomid for 5 days, 100 milligrams, and we repeat the FSH level on day 10. And the thought process behind this test is that initially, Clomid will increase your FSH levels, but if the egg cells that are being stimulated are healthy, they'll secrete increasing amounts of inhibin, and FSH levels will return down to normal. And if they continue to rise, again, that would be an indicator of decreased health of the eggs. More recently, we're beginning to do ultrasounds to look at ovarian or antral follicle pouch. Antral follicles are the small egg cells that begin to develop each month. And as you can see here in the top screens, a woman with nice numbers of antral follicles, all the red little dots, would have a very nice response to medications, regardless of whether they're doing IUIs or whether they're doing in vitro fertilization. IUIs is intrauterine insemination. Whereas a woman with a decreased number of antral follicles, the ovaries are smaller, and you can see that they really have relatively few number of follicles. And these women, unfortunately, will typically have a poor response to fertility medications, and commonly their cycles will be stopped because they won't adequately respond. Well, when should someone start a fertility evaluation? Again, if there's something in your history, if you've had a previous tubal pregnancy, if you've had, you know that your partner has had some injuries to the testicles or a previous history of infertility, again, you may want to start that evaluation earlier. If you're not ovulating, not having regular periods, again, these numbers may not be, these recommendations wouldn't apply. We really basically believe that women under the age of 35 should try for approximately a year before having a workup. And really, I think that anyone 35 or older should probably begin that evaluation after 6 months, because again, the impact of age on fertility. Some people have recommended that any woman over the age of 40 should start an evaluation right away. I think that certainly is a bit aggressive, but we certainly see many women in our office after a relatively short period of time, and that's not unreasonable, and because the impact is such. What are the potential treatment options for couples out there, regardless of age, but primarily in related to as women get older? And I think really the strategy of how we approach the way we treat patients as they get older is that we recommend being more aggressive initially and progress more quickly to more advanced treatments as needed, as opposed to taking a slower approach. Now, again, we also have to tailor this to patients' desires and how they feel about fertility treatment and how far they want to go. But certainly the different options would be expected management, which certainly wouldn't be something that we would encourage patients to do. There's ovulation induction, that's trying to get one egg to grow. Primarily is used in women who have irregular menstrual cycles, something called polycystic ovaries. The two major treatment options that we use for age-related factors would be superovulation with artificial insemination and assisted reproductive technologies, primarily in vitro fertilization. When we look at the way we do the superovulation is that we give people either Clomid with injectable medications or all injectable medications, and we monitor, and we're trying to get anywhere between 2 to 4 mature eggs to grow. And we then place concentrated washed sperm directly into the uterine cavity. And we're trying to really improve the timing of fertilization. We're cheating. We're trying to have more targets for the sperm to make contact with. And what we're trying to do here is trying to return fertility potential back to its baseline. So at the age of 40, if a woman came in to see us and they've been trying for 6 months to a year to conceive, initially when they first started trying, she may have had about a 10% chance of conceiving. After trying for a year, her chances of conceiving is probably, you know, maybe 1, possibly 2% per month. With the superovulation process, we're trying to return that to baseline, somewhere maybe around 8%. Here are sort of the two different treatments. When we look at in vivo means within the body, and in vitro means outside the body. And with in vitro fertilization, what we're doing, again, is we're stimulating the ovaries. We're being more aggressive. We don't mind having 7, 8, 10 eggs grow because we control what goes back into the uterus. The eggs are taken out of the ovaries, and in the laboratory, they're fertilized, and then after a couple of days, we put them back into the body. This is actually showing you an actual egg retrieval. And this is actually showing you the needle going into the follicle, and that fluid's going to be aspirated out. The embryology staff would actually look for the eggs. This is actually just showing you some pictures of the embryology of what we see, and we gain information in regards to egg quality. We primarily base egg quality based upon the first 3 days of embryo development because the first 3 days appear to be more dependent upon the egg than it does on the sperm. And this is showing you a normally fertilized egg. Each of those circles is what we call pronuclei. This is called a 2PN. And each of those circles represents the chromosomes from the male and the female. This is showing you a nice day two embryo with 4 cells. They're nice and round. Again, this is an 8-cell embryo on day 3. And finally, this is a blastocyst, and more recently it's allowing us to potentially have better selection of which embryos to put back in. And this group of cells here is called the inner cell mass, and this is actually what turns into the fetus, hopefully. So we look at the various chances of conceiving with various treatment options. As you can see, once again, as a woman gets older, the ability to conceive with in vitro fertilization decreases. And as you can see, the chances of conceiving with the superovulation process may be as high as 20% in a woman under the age of 35, but then again declines down to around that 8 to 10% and very, very low pregnancy rates over the age of 43. Well, when should someone consider a donor egg? And certainly some of this can be related to, you know, age. You know, we most commonly recommend that not women to do fertility treatment with the use of their own eggs once they reach the age of 44 because of the information that I provided earlier. Some women have premature ovarian failure. For whatever reason, they may have gone through the menopause in their 20s. Maybe couples have done treatment with their own eggs, but unfortunately embryo quality was poor, embryo development was poor. Maybe sometimes people have not responded to the medications. Despite all their testing being normal, we weren't able to get their ovaries stimulated. And that's particularly frustrating because, you know, with everything is normal, we hope that they're going to have a good response. Also, if there's a high incidence of aneuploidy, again, that may be manifested by history of miscarriages or maybe having had a pregnancy where there was a chromosome abnormality. And again, if there's decreased ovarian reserve based upon the day 3 blood testing or Clomid challenge test. Again, this is just a slide, again, demonstrating the certainly the improvements of pregnancy rates in a woman who's doing fertility treatments with her own eggs at the age of 43, unfortunately pregnancy rates are very decreased, but with the use of donor egg, they may have upwards of a 60% delivery rate. I mentioned earlier the pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, and you know, we're commonly using this in women with recurrent miscarriages because one of the most common causes of miscarriages are related to chromosome abnormalities. We're also beginning to see this with increasing frequency with people with unexplained infertility or unsuccessful IVF cycles, and that maybe, in fact, that their infertility is related to the fact that they're making chromosomally abnormal embryos. There are some people who present with miscarriages who are more prone to forming embryos chromosomally abnormal, and some people present with infertility. And it's not uncommon that women with infertility may demonstrate problems with miscarriages in the future, or vice versa. Well, really, in conclusion, and I appreciate your attention, I think it's important that everyone realize that age is a critical indicator of outcomes with fertility treatment. Really, the evaluation and treatment should begin earlier in a woman 35 or older. And there is hope for treatments, and again, with advanced reproductive technologies, a lot of women in their mid-30s, late-30s, and even their early-40s are becoming pregnant. And certainly with the use of donor egg, we're having excellent successes regardless of a woman's age. So I hope you found this seminar to be helpful in regards to insight in regards to what impact age has on fertility. I really hope I didn't scare anyone. That certainly wasn't the intention by any means, but I think having the understanding of why doctors may be recommending various treatments that may seem very aggressive, and that's really based upon the data that's out there. Again, as Patty had mentioned earlier, this is our first webinar. It's certainly been a learning experience for us, and we would like to provide more of these in the future. And if any of you all could, you know, if you have other topics of interest that you'd like to hear us talk about, we certainly would love to hear from you. And if you would email Jennifer Hudson at her email that's showed here, that'd be very helpful. I also want to take this opportunity to really thank Jennifer. She's done a wonderful job working with the conference place in regards to putting this together. Without her, this wouldn't have been possible, as well as her support from Patty Stull, which has been instrumental as well. So I know we can't hear you clapping, but a round of applause for their assistance is at least from my end. We'd be happy to certainly try to...
No, go ahead. This is Patty. Steve and I are talking. We're happy. Several of you have asked us questions as we've gone along through the conference. Some of the questions that you have asked, there's more information that Dr. Greenhouse would need in order to be able to provide a thorough response. We do encourage you to please email your questions to Jennifer and communicate with Jennifer, and together she and Dr. Greenhouse can provide the answers that you're looking for. Right now what we'll do is we can actually take live questions from you. In order for you to ask a live question and to get a response from Dr. Greenhouse, just press *1. So we'll just wait a minute. If anybody has a question, don't be shy.
Your first question comes from Melissa Jericho.
Yes, Melissa.
I wanted to ask you, I'm a patient right now at Shady Grove Fertility, but I guess I'm just a little confused on the variation of FSH and the cycle of the IVF, because I went to my regular OB. I conceived my first healthy child at almost 37. One try, that was it. Perfectly normal pregnancy. Then I went in for baseline because I was 39, and I had never been told that I should check FSH, but through friends, I decided to be proactive. So I went in and to Dr. Beckham, and it was a 40 to 14. So I went straight. He said, go straight to, you know, Shady Grove. So I went in, and I met with, you know, one of your doctors, and he told me, so I went in, and he said, we should do right to IVF, and I had a 15. And he was like, I want to wait and see if it goes down. This month, I had a day 3 at 7.4, great ultrasound. You know I do the Clement challenge. I guess I don't understand. I understand that it spikes up and spikes down as you get older, but how can it go from a borderline, maybe we shouldn't do it, down to a 7.4, which is what like a 25-year-old has, And how does it impact 8 weeks from now, whether you go forward with the cycle, and does your previous conception have anything to do with it? I know that's kind of...
So if I just paraphrase your question, you tell me if it's correct. Essentially what you're asking is, what accounts for the variations and...
how does it impact the rest of the procedure, and how can it dip? I understand that it dips, and I went to a seminar with Dr. Sebastian on that in person, but I know it dips, but from what I understood from what he showed us in a graph, it typically dips within a certain range as you get older. I don't understand how it could dip from a 14 and 15 down to a 7.4. To me, when I've looked at all the research, a 7.4 is what you have when you're 25.
Right. So let me just start by saying the FSH levels that the FSH levels aren't correlated. So not a 7 isn't equal to 25, and a 9 is equal to someone who's 37.
No, I realize that.
I'm just explaining that for the mm-hmm. rest of the audience.
Mm-hmm.
The variations of FSH levels is somewhat of a mystery to us as well. What we believe it may be related to is related to potentially the eggs that are growing that month. That we do know that FSH levels do vary, and I think the reason for repeating the test was to make certain that it was no higher. Now, certainly there are women out there who have higher FSH levels, and despite having a higher FSH levels, they respond fairly well to medications. So I think you got to put in conjunction, certainly with history, having had a baby at the age of, 37 quickly, and now, you're 39. I mean, I think...
Does that have a big impact? I'm just curious, all the research, I don't see anything that links. I mean, I guess I don't understand. Is there any study that's been done that shows... I mean, obviously 37 isn't young either, and I guess that's considered advanced age. I mean,
right.
What is the...
Let me just answer the questions. I want to give everyone else opportunities to try to ask questions.
Okay.
I think I have not seen studies actually saying that if a woman got pregnant at the age of 37, she has a better chance of getting pregnant at the age of 39. But I think that those things can, I think, play in your favor. I think it just makes somewhat of an intuitive sense. So it does vary, and it is frustrating, but we do need to counsel you based upon the highest level. And again, there are some women who have a great response despite having a higher level.
And what is your absolute cutoff that you had combined for?
I think you're really going to need to discuss that with you.
Okay, I mean, this is getting too... You're just doing it in general. Okay, I understand.
Okay. So I was going to go ahead and take another question.
Your next question comes from Tanya Greenfield.
Yes, Tanya.
Our line is open. There's no response. I will go to the next.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I did go through one cycle, but I didn't get... to go through the complete cycle because I only had 3 follicles and the standard is 5. Why is that?
I'm assuming you meant an in vitro cycle.
Yeah, IVF, right.
Right. Well, again, that's probably why, it could be related to either the protocol, or certainly could be related to, as I said, as age, it plays a big role in regards to ability to conceive. So, that might signify some decreased ovarian reserve, and I suspect that the reason your cycle was stopped was because maybe your doctor felt that you possibly in the future could do better.
Okay, because,
Not that I don't want to answer your specific question, but
right.
I just think that without knowing your history, your age...
I'm 41 now. I was 40 at the time.
And then that probably accounts for the lower response to medication.
I was just wondering, why wouldn't you try with 3? Why would you have to have 5?
Well, I think, each, based on history, it's just that there are risks associated with egg retrieval, and maybe they are hoping with a different medication protocol you would do better. Possibly in your second cycle, if that happened again, then they may really consider going to retrieval.
Okay.
So, well, good luck to you.
Thank you.
Next question.
Your next question comes from Mindy Yargi.
Dr. Greenow.
Yes.
I recently turned 30 just about 2 weeks ago, and everything was looking good with infertility treatments. I've just been going through the testing, except that my FSH level came back at a 12.5. I haven't done the Clomid-Towns test yet, but is there any research saying that my age, even though the FSH level is high, that my age will sort of help me to have kind of an advantage to get pregnant through these treatments?
It's actually a very common and very good question. It isn't really a black and white issue, but it appears that age is the most important predictor of egg quality, and FSH levels is a more important predictor of egg number. Again, there is overlap.
Okay.
I think what this tells us is that what we're seeing with our patients, at least, is that if a woman has a higher FSH level and they're young and we're able to get enough eggs to harvest, that their pregnancy rates are not dramatically different than a woman who has a normal FSH level. The cycle cancellation rate is higher. So as opposed to a woman normally 30 may have a 10 to 15% chance of cycle cancellation, your cancellation rate may be, you know, more like 25 or 30%. But again, we hope that with good egg quality that even though we may get fewer eggs, the embryos would be of good quality. Now, there is a cutoff. Being 30 with an FSH level of 12.5 is different than a woman 30 having an FSH level of 25, or a woman 41 or 42 with an FSH level of 12.5. So we have to take everything in conjunction. But no, I think that, you know, I would recommend being more aggressive with your treatments as opposed to less aggressive. But I think your age is in your favor. Next question.
Your next question comes from Virginia Houston.
Yes.
Hello. I'm 41, and I just had my last IVF with Dr. Chang in March. And I had the best response I've ever had. My FSH tests have always come back really low, like around a 7 or an 8. However, like in my last IVF cycles, they've barely gotten two or three eggs. And anyway, I ended up having 8 eggs, but none of them fertilized. I didn't even get to go through
that's obviously very, very, very disappointing. And certainly, you know, I would suspect, given your history of having had several cycles in the past with only 2 or 3 eggs and age, that the lack of fertilization was probably related to an egg quality issue. Mm-hmm. And I think I certainly, you know, would discuss that with Dr. Chang, because he certainly knows your history better.
Right. Well, I guess my question is, I've never had a Clomid challenge test. Would that be relevant?
I don't think in your particular case. The Clomid challenge test may be a good initial screening test, but if someone's had relatively low responses to fertility medications in the past, they may not actually, it's not going to be any particularly helpful. And I think that, you know, a good question that we can kind of, you know, end on in regards to is, when should a Clomid challenge test really be done? And, I mean, I commonly will do a Clomid challenge test on women with long-standing history of infertility. Women over the age of 40, women who are smokers, or women who've had a lot of pelvic surgeries in the past. And I think the primary reason for doing the Clomid challenge test there is really to determine really what is their probability of conception. Because a normal Clomid challenge test doesn't mean everything is fine. An abnormal Clomid challenge test, unfortunately, is associated with a decreased response to medication and a decreased chances of conceiving.
Right.
So I don't think a Clomid challenge test would be helpful in your particular case.
Okay. Well, could I ask one more question?
I'd like to give someone else an opportunity.
Okay, sure.
Thank you.
The next question comes from Malta Parma.
I'm husband of Malti Parmar, and Malti is 32 years old and I'm 36 years old, and we have everything normal, and we did the first IUI cycle, and somehow we are not able to get the result from the first IUI treatment, and Malti's FSH is 7.50. So is that normal FSH, or, and like we already just started a second IUI cycle and doctor stopped taking some of the medication in the second IUI cycle. So what would be the reason of doing that thing?
I think, without knowing her history, and I think you need to discuss that with your doctor. Again, not that I don't want to answer your question, but, you know, your wife is relatively young and normal FSH level, and, you know, unfortunately the chances of success with the IUI cycle is maybe around, you know, 15 to 18% for your wife. So, but I think you need to ask specifically your doctor. I can't give that advice over the phone.
But we are, like, everything we have normal.
I understand, sir. I think that it's really difficult to answer your question specifically. Can we go to the next question, please?
Your next question comes from Christine Fish.
Hey, Dr. Greenhouse.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
Okay.
I was just interested in knowing what kind of things you guys look for after a failed IVF. You know, what kind of statistics or, you know, cycle review do you do when you look at, you know, should there be another cycle, and, you know, what improvements or what changes might you make?
Well, I mean, I think the things we look at, obviously, is history, and we, you know, obviously look at response to medications, we look at the embryo development, we look at the age of the part of the female, and we kind of put everything together in regards to what we think their chances of success will be in the future. So I think that that's sort of the way we kind of look at everything kind of in a global view in regards to whether to recommend treatment for someone else, another treatment cycle. And I think also part of that has to do with, you know, patients' desires. You know, each couple sort of has their cutoff of when they're certainly be willing to move forward with other options or to stop.
Great. Thanks for the seminar.
I'll give you a call tomorrow.
Great.
Okay.
Thanks.
At this time, there are no further questions. Are there any closing remarks?
Well, I'd just like to say thank you very much for attending the web seminar. And again, feedback would be very helpful in regards to us improving this in the future. And certainly feel free to check out our website for more information. It's www.shadygrovefertility.com. And again, you know, please take this information back. If you have questions, you know, raise them with your doctor or with your OBGYN for advice of where to proceed. But again, thank you, and have a nice evening.
This concludes tonight's conference call. You may now disconnect.